Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Derek Larson. I'm the priest here at Good Shepherd, and it is such an honor to be here with you today to celebrate and remember the life of Joseph James de Alessandro. You know, in life, there are times for celebration, and there are times for mourning, and sometimes those times are at the same time. And so my hope and prayer for us today is that we have space for both celebration and for mourning as we remember Joe's life. Just a few notes about the service. As an Episcopal church, the liturgy today comes from the Red Book of Common Prayer that you'll find somewhere around you in your pew or under your chair. Much of the service will be included in the service bulletin, but there are portions of the service that you'll find in the Book of Common Prayer. And if you'd like to follow along, there are page numbers in the bulletin so that you can see where that will be. We'll also be receiving communion today, and I want you to know that in the Episcopal Church, no matter your tradition, if you're baptized in the Catholic Church, the Methodist Church, Episcopal Church, whatever church you belong to, you're welcome at God's table. And even if you're not baptized, please come forward and give a blessing. If you'd like to stay in your seat, you're welcome to do that as well. However you're comfortable, we want you to be able to participate in today's service, and I'll say just a bit more about that when the time comes. Finally, Joe was a veteran, and he served in the Army in the Second World War, and so we begin our service today with military honors. After the military honors, we'll begin with the first hymn, hymn 427. We'll be singing the first three verses of 427. But we begin with military honors, so I invite you to stand at this time. I am resurrection and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though he die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awaking, he will raise me up, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold him, who is my friend and not a stranger. For none of us has life in himself, and none becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord. And if we die, we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession. Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, who by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light, grant that your servant Joe, being raised with him, may know the strength of his presence and rejoice in his eternal glory, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of the lessons.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint heart spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, to display his glory. The word of the Lord. The psalm appointed today is Psalm number 139, which is found in your bulletin. We will read the psalm in unison. Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it altogether. You press upon me behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go then from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I climb up to heaven, you are there. If I make the grave my bed, you are there also. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the utmost parts of the sea, even there your hand will lead me, and your right hand hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will cover me, and the light around me to turn to night, darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light to you are both alike. A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. In fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. For since death came between human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. For as all die in Adam, so all will be made alive in Christ, but each in his own order. Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed every ruler and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? Fool, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And as for what you sow, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a physical body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body. For this perishable body must be put on imperishability, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable body puts on imperishability, and the mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. The word of the Lord.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. At this time, I'd like to invite Joe's son, Stu, to come and share with us a few words about his father.
Good afternoon. It's hard to imagine the world without Joe Dulles syndrome in it. I know I'm a bit biased, but I really mean it. If it's true that we send ripples out in the world by our actions, by our thoughts, then we've lost a very important source of very good ripples. My father was a man who lived deliberately, kindly, generously, and with humor. More than enough good ripples for one life. It's impossible to cover a life like this in just a few words, but I wanted to share some thoughts because Joe really did live an extraordinary life, and he was an extraordinary man. As many of you know, Joe D'Alessandro was a bold man. He was decisive, opinionated, and uncompromising. He would tell you exactly what he thought, whether or not you liked it. He was sometimes diplomatic, but always truthful. To paraphrase Frank Sinatra, Joe D'Alessandro was someone who did it his way. Joe D'Alessandro was bold, but he was also a humble man. He never treated others as less than him. Regardless of what your station was in life, he would treat you as an equal. He would treat you with respect. It was an incredible example for us growing up. Joe was a man of faith. I can't recall any time when he wasn't actively involved in the Episcopal Church, whether it was worship, being involved in some committee, or a vestry member, or even volunteering at the penny shop. He was always active in the church, and again, was a great example for all of us. My father was a practical man. He was frugal. It was an important lesson that he learned growing up in the Depression. He remembered, recount a story of when he was a child and he asked his mother for 5 cents for some candy, and she told him that they couldn't afford it. He was embarrassed. And he vowed never to ask anything of his mother again. And he kept to that vow, and from that point on, he went out to work and earned every penny that he had from that point forward. He was rarely ostentatious, except when it came to treating others. At that point, there was no amount too high. My father was a brilliant businessman. He had keen instincts about people. He could estimate the cost of building, putting together a building construction project using just a pencil and paper. He rarely used a calculator, never used a computer. Up until his passing, he did math problems still in his head. He would track the stock market daily, and even before he closed his eyes for his final rest that night, I sat with him and he said, "How'd the stock market do today?" "Now give me some symbols." "Oh, that one's down a little bit. That one's okay, not too bad." It was true that my father could be demanding. He liked things just so. He had a strong sense of what was right and wrong, and he would let you know what he wanted. He was a connoisseur of fine foods. We would have to wait for everyone to vacate the house before we could prepare our favorite chicken livers and onions. But it was always worth the wait. My father was a disciplinarian, but more importantly, he was a teacher. It seemed that when we were very little, we were always one transgression away from getting the belt or the wooden spoon, but somehow we never actually got it. When we were a little bit older, it was harder because a transgression might lead to being sent to your room and think about what your punishment should be. It was torture. And it always took me 2 or 3 times to come up with a sufficient enough punishment. But we learned. It wasn't always easy, but we always learned from my father. And if you've met Joe, you know that he was funny. He was always ready with a joke, whether he knew you or not. My teenage friends, they didn't always know if he was joking. And I remember one of them saying, "I don't think your father likes me." And I said, "If he didn't like you, he wouldn't joke with you. So you're okay." And what you may not know is when he participated with the good guys on Friday mornings, my father was the guy who would bring in the jokes for the week. And most of them were church appropriate. Some of them pushed the boundaries just a little bit. but he always got a laugh. My father was a man of action. He was a doer. When a decision was made, it was time to act, and to act now. He was generous, and my father's generosity came in a way that was really unique. He had a way that when he was helping you, he would make you feel as if you were somehow doing him a favor. You know, I don't want to have to sell this car. It's difficult. Can I just give it to you? That's how Joe operated in the world. Most of all, he was a most dedicated father and husband. So much of what he did was in service to his family, supporting us, teaching us, and providing for us in so many ways, and leading us by his example. I'm not sure that he ever felt that he had done enough for his family. There's that humility again. And even in his later years, he would lie awake at night worrying about his family. And it was a comfort to be able to let him know that we are all very well provided for, thanks to him. So it's impossible to sum up a life like this in just a few words. But if our actions do send ripples out into the world, I would like to think that we all, in some way, having been in the presence of Joe D'Alessandro, echo the ripples that he started, ripples of goodness, humor, generosity, honesty, and fairness. Thank you.
Thank you, Stu, for sharing. It's a real honor to be able to hear your words about your father. You know, I've been here at Good Shepherd for just over a year, and because I've been here for such a short time, most of the funerals that I've done for folks, I didn't actually get to meet them or know them. And so it was a real honor to be able to spend even just a little bit of time with Joe over the last few weeks before he died. I visited him a few times in the hospital, and we got to spend some time just talking and chatting with one another, and he'd share stories about his life, and Joe loved to tell stories. He loved to joke. And we talked about his family, his wife Connie, his whole family, his dog Sophie, of course. We'd pray together. But what struck me most about these conversations is that Joe was unafraid of death. In fact, he really wanted to die. At 96 years old, he said to me straight out, "I've lived a long and wonderful life, and I'm just ready to go." He was in a lot of pain, and he didn't understand why it was that God still wanted him here. And so we talked about that. And we talked about why God wants any of us here to love. God puts us on this planet to love, whether we're 6 years old or 96 years old, whether we're sick or healthy, we are here to love. And Joe was a loving man. He was also a tough man. And as a child of the Great Depression, as a soldier of the Second World War, as a builder like his father, he really had to be. But as Connie has shared with me, he was as gentle as he was tough. And it occurs to me that the same is true of love. Love is as gentle as it is tough. The hands of love are calloused from hard work, but warm in the touch of embrace. Such was the message of Jesus to his disciples in the passage that I read just a few moments ago. The passage says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." This is Jesus' farewell message to his disciples. He knows that he's about to die. And so he offers them these words, and they are tough to hear, but they are gentle to receive. The one that they love is leaving them. And yet the one they love is preparing a place for them. I imagine some of us have similar feelings today. Joe is gone. And that is a tough truth to bear. And yet if we hear the words of Jesus today, we know that in this very moment, right now, Joe is at peace with God. And that is a comfort, a comfortable truth to hear. And because Joe is with Christ, the words of Christ can become the words of Joe. So that we hear him say to us today the same things that Jesus said to his disciples so long ago. Joe says to us, to you, do not let your hearts be troubled. I go to prepare a place for you. And as an owner of a construction company, we can trust Joe knows something about building places for people. So this afternoon, as we remember the love of Joe, and we rest in the love of Christ, let us also be inspired by their example and love one another. Amen. Please stand. We continue our service in your bulletin with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. For our brother Joe, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Joe, and dry the tears of those who weep. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. You raised the dead to life. Give to Joe eternal life. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring Joe to the joys of heaven. Joe was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints. Joe was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our brother Joe. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Father of all, we pray to you for Joe and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. May his soul and the souls of all the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. I invite you to greet one another in peace. Our service continues with the offertory hymn, page 680 in the blue hymnal, 680. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us in offering and sacrifice to God. Mass is offered today in honor of Joseph de Alessandro. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead and comforts us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. For to your faithful people, O Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when our mortal body lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. The gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. As you come forward to receive today, if you'd like to receive just the bread, you can hold your palms out like this. That's full participation in the sacrament. If you'd like to receive the bread and wine together, then fold your hands like this, and I will dip the bread for you and hand it to you. Today, we're not going to sip from the cup, but I'll dip the bread for you and hand it to you. So like this for bread, like this for bread and wine. And if you'd like to come forward and not receive, but receive a blessing, cross your arms like this, or you can simply stay at your seat. However you feel welcome to participate, you are welcome. So come now, or please be seated as you wait your turn. Please stand. Our service continues with the post-communion prayer found in your bulletin. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you that in your great love you have fed us with the spiritual food and drink of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and have given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. Grant that this sacrament may be to us a comfort in affliction and a pledge of our inheritance in that kingdom where there is no death, neither sorrow nor crying, but the fullness of joy with all your saints. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Joe. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. And now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you now and remain with you always. Amen. Our service continues with the committal service in our columbarium. We'll invite you to join the procession following the family.
The end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear.
And on a sound issue, just a moment.
Too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Yes, there. I'm sure you knew when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got if not himself? Then he has not to say he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way.
We continue on the last page of your bulletin, the committal. Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling Spirit. My heart is therefore is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. In sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother Joe, and we commit his body to its resting place. earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious to him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Rest eternal grant to him, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon him. May his soul and the souls of all the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. The God of peace who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you all for coming today. Many blessings. Blessings
to
you.
Thank you so much, Father. Mm-hmm. It was a beautiful service.
Thank you. It's a blessing. I'll let you go.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway and more. Much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I
bit off, more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way.
I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way. It was my